Just for the record, go ahead and state your appearance again.
I'm back. Again, good morning. My name is Jim Jellison, and I represent the 13 individual defendants that are named in the Denby matter. And as I did before, I'd like to reserve 3 minutes for rebuttal. This case, again, also, as the one we just discussed, implicates the evolution of qualified immunity and really brings us to where we are now, where the U.S. Supreme Court has taken us and where this court has now taken us. You know, as you look back on qualified immunity, it's an interesting evolution. I think the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals has been reversed by the Supreme Court 6 or 7 times since 2011. And we are now getting at the stage where we're seeing more decisions from the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals that do truly focus and search for that clearly established law that has to have been violated. And I think that evolution is playing itself out even at the district court level. The practicing in federal court here in the District of Arizona is fantastic. We have fantastic judges. They're engaging, they're professional, they're intelligent. But still, when it comes to qualified immunity, we almost see the same thing playing out in the district that played out with the Ninth Circuit, and that is some resistance and difficulty in applying qualified immunity in the way that the U.S. Supreme Court has required it to be played out. And Sharp versus County of Orange tells us, again, we need to look for specific cases, particularly in the Fourth Amendment context, that will give every reasonable officer notice that what they're doing is wrong. The claimant bears the burden of proof, the burden to show that clearly established law. In my briefs, I try to show the court law that would apply, that would put officers on notice that either what they're doing is right or at least it's not proscribed by any law. But I don't do that because I have the burden to do it. I do that to show all of you that the issues are not beyond debate.
Yes, let me ask you about kind of in line with what you just spoke about. In our Keats decision, our court said, and it says at 1242, it says, on a motion to dismiss, we, meaning this court, must decide whether the complaint plausibly alleges that each of the defendants was an integral participant in the violation. As I read Keats, and there's some other out-of-circuit case law, it suggests that when you have a multiple officer situation like we have here, the district court, when faced with a qualified immunity motion, needs to go through each officer and say, A, B, C, here's what A did, here's what B did, and analyze them individually. First, I want to hear you from 2 points. One, is my reading of the Ninth Circuit law correct on that point? And second, if it is correct, did that happen here? I didn't see an individualized analysis. I can't tell why Officer 7 is treated the same or different as Officer number 2.
I'll answer the two questions. Yeah. Number one, I do agree that there has to be an individualized assessment, and that goes back to Schumann versus Wright and follows through Keats versus Coyle. And if a plaintiff wants to go ahead and sue 5, 10, 13, 20, 50 people, they got to do the work to show that a constitutional violation has been plausibly pled that withstands the application of qualified immunity. I mean, that's the standard that Keats set. Never happened in this case.
And there needs to be an analysis for each officer. You can't just say the officers. You have to say Officer Alpha did this, and Officer Brown did this, and Officer Charlie did this.
And in fact, if you look at the excerpt of records, that's exactly what our motion was based on. If you look at our original motion to dismiss, well, not original, the motion to dismiss the second amended complaint, we not only stated what qualified immunity requires, we looked at each aspect of this particular search warrant or arrest warrant execution and globally, but then looked at every individual. What is it alleged that they individually did, and pointed out that what is alleged individually doesn't amount to a constitutional violation by any of them, much less a constitutional violation that is proscribed by clearly established law.
Counsel, the complaint says that SWAT team members, and this I agree, this what I'm going to talk about doesn't talk about individuals by name. But in paragraph 113, it says the team members demolished anything and everything they could get their hands on. 116, furniture too small to hide a human body was crushed, smashed, thrown against walls, otherwise destroyed. 121, homeowner property tossed aside and stomped and smashed, including television, artwork, heirlooms, antiques, and other items. And then 123 and 137 says the entire residence was destroyed and rendered uninhabitable. Why isn't that an obvious, as alleged, an obvious constitutional violation that in looking for the suspect and then sending in what they did, they also went in individually and destroyed things that could have nothing to do with concealing a human being?
As you pointed out, Your Honor, even if you concluded that that damage was caused by an individual as opposed to the administration of chemical munitions into the residence, the introduction of flashbangs or NFDDs into the residence, it doesn't state that any of these named people did any of those things. But really, based on the totality of the allegations...
How would the plaintiffs know who did what at the pleading stage, where they would have no way... They knew who was on the scene, they knew some of the people who went in, they knew people who were part of sort of the collective effort, but how would they know to be able to allege at a pleading stage who smashed the things? Because I think fairly read that's what they've alleged.
And that's a bigger question than just this case. Now, in this case, I believe they know this because they, in Arizona, you can get the records and you can get the underlying reports, and that's why you can create a 130-paragraph complaint like we see in this case. But the law tells us that until qualified immunity is decided, and even until a plausible claim has been established, that doesn't unlock the keys to discovery. And that's been the law of the U.S. Supreme Court since 2009. That doesn't mean, however, that these 13 individuals who aren't accused of doing any of those things aren't entitled to qualified immunity now. And that is what brings us here before the court. The other thing I'm going to add about those allegations is they are conclusions. I think the case that almost resolves all of the issues that are involved here is the one that this court issued in July of 2019, and it's the West versus Caldwell case. And West versus Caldwell dealt with a fact pattern that is very, very similar to this, with some exceptions. A wanted felon enters into a third party's home. In that case, the difference there is that the third party gave consent for the search. In this case, we had a specific warrant to go in and get Mr. Ochoa. In that case, chemical munitions were used. In that case, property damage within the residence was alleged. And in that case, the court said, we have found no Supreme Court or Ninth Circuit case clearly establishing that the procedure defendants followed, including the use of tear gas and the resulting destruction, is unreasonable in these circumstances.
But the court also said there that this wasn't a case where there were allegations that people intentionally destroyed things within the home. And in this complaint, I think, at least potentially fairly read, there is an allegation that the team members in searching the home themselves destroyed property that could not possibly have concealed a human being. So I think that distinguishes it potentially from West.
Well, there's no question that property was destroyed. I mean, we know chemical munitions were launched into the residence.
I understand that, but I think a perhaps fair reading of the complaint is that this wasn't damage that was all caused by the chemical munitions, but instead was damage that was caused by people, the SWAT team members themselves, after they entered the house. Although I would agree that there is some ambiguity there from the way the complaint is pled.
Well, and those same types of allegations didn't satisfy this court in West versus City of Caldwell. In West versus City of Caldwell, the court looked at similar allegations and said, damage is going to occur. It hasn't been sufficiently and plausibly alleged in a way that gets qualified immunity thrown out of the picture, unless you start getting into some of the things that Mina versus I think Simi Valley talked about, and that is officers who can be demonstrably shown to have, and in that case, broke a door that was already open. They broke a door that was already open and said, I like doing this because it's cool.
But again, in paragraph 116, the complaint says, furniture that was objectively too small to hide a human body was thrown against walls. I mean, that obviously is not a reference to the munitions or the flash bombs or the pepper spray grenades that were introduced into the house.
And I don't know, and things could get moved, pushed aside, damaged, destroyed, as a SWAT team enters a, 1,200-foot residence with chemical munitions having been introduced, with their gas masks on. But the complaint doesn't plausibly distinguish one from the other. And I go back to this point, the complaint clearly does not identify any of the individual defendants in this case as having caused that damage. And we can't just throw up our hands in the air and say, well, then, you know, we're not going to give qualified immunity to these 13 individuals. They're entitled to it at this stage. And it's not a case where the plaintiff hasn't had a chance to make some changes. This is based on the third iteration of their complaint that we're here. But the Supreme Court teaches us this. Resolve qualified immunity at the earliest possible moment, and do that by looking at the plausible, well-pled facts, and look at the clearly established law that applies to that conduct. Again, when we look at this complaint and we look at the allegations that apply to these 13 individuals, these plaintiffs did not do their work. They didn't do their work in responding to the motion, they didn't do their work in drafting their complaint, and they didn't do the work on appeal here because they didn't provide us with the clearly established law to show that using flashbangs under these circumstances is unconstitutional, that using chemical munitions the way they were used here has been clearly established to be prescribed under the Constitution, and even, Your Honor, some of the damage that you're talking about has been clearly established to be prescribed in the execution of a search warrant or an arrest warrant in a small residence under circumstances like these. With that, I know I'm down to 2.5 minutes. I'd like to reserve the time.
You got it.
Thank you.
Good morning. May it please the court. Sean Woods on behalf of the plaintiffs, appellees. I think just to get right to it, talking about the law that we've cited in support of our complaint, we do cite to Boyd versus Benton County. We do cite to Mina versus City of Simi Valley. We talk about Chuman versus Wright. All of those cases discuss either the integral participant or the excessive use of force or destruction of property.
I'm going to start even earlier. In the district court here, sought to defer a ruling.
That's correct.
And I can't figure out what basis the district court could possibly have to do that, given that the Supreme Court has made a habit of telling us that this is immunity and defendants are entitled to get this examined at the earliest possible opportunity, and that includes a motion to dismiss. And the district court didn't do it. So how can we justify the district court's decision to punt?
Under Keats, I think that Keats provides the proposition that the district court does not have to decide qualified immunity if the district court defers it for limited factual discovery.
But why? Why factual discovery? There is a legitimate basis for saying factual discovery is necessary if the question is whether somebody's entitled to immunity, as in absolute immunity. Was somebody acting in a capacity, such as a prosecutor, that supports absolute immunity? And there are cases that talk about that.
Sure.
I have yet to encounter a case that says, well, this is too close, I'm not going to worry myself about this. I'm not going to decide a motion to dismiss, which I think defendants are entitled to get a decision on. And I'm kind of baffled as to how we're supposed to unfold back to the point in time when they get that decision, because they can't. They've been stuck in this case for years.
Yeah.
Is there anything to justify that you can offer that would justify the district court's decision to punt?
I think the idea that the district court did dismiss claims in this case based on qualified immunity, but allowed for an amendment, and the amendment was made by plaintiffs. The amendments specifically detail what individual officers were doing at the scene of this.
Now, is that a complaint that we have in front of us, or is that one that was subsequently filed?
That would have been the second amended complaint.
Okay, and you're telling us that it gives specific allegations that are sufficient to evaluate the performance of each defendant?
Well, for instance, Sergeant Rory Skeetle, in the record, I think it's paragraph 78, we say that he was aware that the decision was made to use the Bearcat as a battering ram. And there's
there are two paragraphs, 78 and 79, that are remarkably conclusory. No decision, and then 79, listing all their names, knew that using it was a violation of the plaintiff's constitutional rights. I don't think that's going to pass muster under anybody's evaluation as to whether sufficient facts have been alleged to hold a given individual responsible. I mean, look at the briefing here, and the defendant's brief goes through each of the cast of characters. And I understand it's difficult at this stage, but I didn't see anything in the answering brief that sought to respond to that as to why each of these individuals should not qualify for immunity at this stage.
Well, I think the
issue isn't that what the law requires?
It does. And I think the issue that we have right now is that via public records request, we've received police reports, but we haven't received rosters of who the SWAT team members were. So prior to filing this, we just didn't know which members of the SWAT teams were the ones that actually entered the home. And that's what we're hoping to get to.
So can you point me to any precedent that says what the Supreme Court says about having an opportunity to challenge or seek entitlement to qualified immunity at the beginning, at the stage of a motion to dismiss? Nope, the district court can disregard that because you got to have discovery first. I got to tell you, I've seen no such authority.
I agree with you. There isn't.
So how do you get a pass here?
So we move past the deferment issue and we talk about the actual issues related to the qualified immunity argument.
But you haven't given us any allegations that specify what each defendant has done. And if all we have is this, I guess it's the second amended complaint, and it doesn't do that, then how could we possibly say defendant Beta isn't entitled to qualified immunity based on this, because there are no allegations here that specify what Officer Beta did?
Sure. And I think you turn then to the integral participant theory, the analysis that comes down under those cases, and you look at the fact that in Langford versus Superior, use of a Bearcat was objectively unreasonable, and it was objectively unreasonable because the doors were unlocked. In this case, we've alleged that the doors were wide open to the home, and not only that, the homeowner provided the keys to the police officers and said, here, you can open the door, go in, do what you need to do. Instead of using those tools, they drove the Bearcat over the fence, knocked out windows, broke down doors, shut.
In terms of the entry into the home,
how would a reasonable police officer know that they didn't have the right to break into a home to make sure that by entering personally, they weren't going to be confronted by a dangerous suspect?
Well, there are facts alleged in the complaint that the suspect was not armed, contrary to what the police said.
Well, I said dangerous. The complaint alleges that he had outstanding warrants. The complaint alleges that he had been been accused of being in a serious domestic. What case would tell a reasonable officer under those circumstances that they had to personally go in the house as opposed to using some other destructive means in order to see if a dangerous suspect was inside?
I think that the question should be more along the lines of, again, the totality of what happened here. We've alleged that they saw movement under a tarp outside of the home, and they never investigated the movement under that tarp. Instead, they spent the next 8 hours firing 22 canisters of tear gas and pepper spray into a 1,200 square foot home. They used the Bearcat, they used the bullhorn to call out to Mr. Ochoa, please come out of the house. They put two robots into the house and searched the house with these two robots and found no sign of him in the house. After 8 hours of all of this, they said, let's just breach the house. And they sent a SWAT team in, and as you've seen in the record, destroyed everything. Sledgehammer to a toilet. It was excessive. It was beyond reasonable use of force in regards to, like I said, Mina versus City of Simi Valley, Langford versus Superior, Boyd versus Benton. They also threw flashbang devices. And again, they had noticed earlier in the day that there was movement under this tarp on a car that was being stored. And where did they find the suspect? In that exact spot, after destroying the house. Suspect was not in the house. And I should also argue that this case is different than other cases in the sense that the suspect was not the homeowner. The suspect just decided to come into this home. The homeowner was there the whole time with the police, watching them destroy his house. And the police are just saying, that was fine. You know, we're allowed to shoot a canister that will cover 1,300 square feet into a 1,200 square foot house, but we're gonna shoot 22 of them and destroy everything in this person's house. And everything was rendered destroyed. The chemical munitions were so much so that it even soaked into the ground. And so the environmental consultants have said you have to remove a certain portion of the topsoil on the property. I mean, this man's house was destroyed. He had no relation to the guy, the suspect that they were searching for, and the officers had knowledge that the suspect wasn't in the house. They try to say that they don't, or they don't have that knowledge, but it's very clear in the police reports. We see movement. Their response is there's a dog in the neighborhood.
So, I mean, the pitch you're making sounds to me like there is very possibly if we believe your side of the case, you got a case. I think the concern that I have, and I think maybe that Judge Clifton shares, is we're not exactly sure who the case is against, particularly, because you've used the word like officers. And to get back to Judge Clifton's point, which is the point I was making with opposing counsel, is that, you know, as I read the Ninth Circuit's law, there needs to be an individualized analysis by officer. And I understand that's difficult for you at this stage. But there are some officers that you know, and at least in your theory of the case, are clearly on the hook here, from your view. And what would be the concern? I know you want this case to move forward, and I'm talking about moving it backwards. But if we were to remand this case to the district court just to say, look, you need to give us an individualized analysis as to each officer. Once that's done, then we can actually review who's actually in play, who's not in play, and go forward, as opposed to now, where you've used the terms like officers, which I think is appropriate this term, but we're trying to balance your case with what the Supreme Court has said, that there needs to be that individualized analysis as early as possible. So what about a remand in this case, just to get that done so this case can move forward the way you want it to move forward?
Honestly, we have no problem with that.
Okay. The case has been in the district court. Has anything happened? The last order permitted another amended complaint, or has it been frozen while?
It's been frozen. There was a motion to stay proceedings that was granted. So we've been languishing for 4 years trying to move forward past the motion to dismiss stage. There's nothing further I'd submit.
Thank you very much, counsel, for your argument.
The review that's being undertaken by this panel today is a de novo review, and you can take a look at the facts that are alleged and take them to be absolutely true, at least as they're pled against the individuals who are named.
Okay, so counsel, we could take as true, for example, what you're saying is, say, paragraph 155 of the complaint. Defendants Lepre, Engstrom, Skettle, Gregg, and Robinson knew that Ochoa was not in the house, but still proceeded with destroying nearly all, if not all, of plaintiff's property within the residence for the purpose of qualified immunity. We can take that as true.
Well, and in my briefs, I made it clear that conclusory statements can't and shouldn't be. That's about as conclusory as I can imagine an allegation
being.
It says
they knew he was in the house, that he wasn't in the house.
Yeah, and that is actually inconsistent with the well-pled allegations of the complaint that the last time anybody saw Ochoa, he appeared out briefly and then went immediately back into the residence.
I don't disagree with you on that, but they do allege in 154 that a number of officers destroyed property, and then in 155, people knew he wasn't in the house. What I understand we can review this de novo, but would you have an objection to Judge Owens' suggestion?
I would have an objection because it's contrary to the purpose of qualified immunity. Qualified immunity for Sheriff Babu, for Horn, for LaPree, for Lujan, for all these guys means that they shouldn't be dragged into this any further if clearly established law as to the allegations related to their conduct, and not the conclusions, but the real allegations, don't support a claim. And again, I think West versus City of Caldwell answered the question. Given the unusual circumstances of this case, the need for specificity of precedent in the Fourth Amendment context, and controlling cases establishing that officers can sometimes damage a home during a search without violating the occupant's Fourth Amendment rights, this is not an obvious case in which to deny qualified immunity without any controlling precedent clearly establishing that defendants violated plaintiff's rights. That's the principle we should be applying in this case.
Thank you very much, counsel. Thank you both for your argument today. This matter is submitted, and this panel is in recess. Thank you.